So, welcome to the Parson series, guys, and this is part two of the cornea. So, if you remember, we had already talked about the anatomy, physiology, and the biochemistry of the cornea in our last topic, and today we are dealing with the pathophysiology, the pathology in cornea. All right. So, the importance of the diseases of the cornea lies in the fact that they often leave the permanent opacities, and obviously, they are going to diminish the visual acuity. Why we are basically concerned about the opacities in the cornea? Because cornea was transparent, it was the most important refractive surface, and obviously, if there is opacity, there will be diminution of vision, and basically that is the reason why we are concerned about it. All right, now if you talk about the associated complications, which not infrequently follow, may even lead to complete loss of vision. So obviously, if there are pathologies in the cornea, they can lead to corneal opacity, and corneal opacity can lead to simple blind and even the complete loss of vision. Now, besides causing opacity, these are also certain diseases like we have keratoconus, keratoglobus, which are also affecting the vision by altering the shape and curvature and leading to a changes in the refractive status also. So, cornea is something which is affecting the visual acuity also, and even it is causing the problems of astigmatism because there is a change in the curvature also. So, normally the surface of the cornea, you know, is the biconvex one, something like this. It means it is convex, rather, sorry, it is actually the convex and concave. But when you have the keratoconus or you have keratoglobus, you have the problems with the curvature and it becomes globular in shape or it becomes conical in shape. Obviously, we will have change in the curvature and that will cause the problems of astigmatism. All right. Now, the major pathological changes that occur are, so what are the major problems? They are actually the keratitis, corneal ulceration, scarring, and opacification. So basically, we will be focusing upon these four things. Let us start with the very first one, that is your keratitis. Keratitis is any kind of inflammation. So you already know that the word kerato is used for the cornea, and itis means inflammation. So simply, keratitis is the inflammation, so nothing to cram about. So inflammation is again a very, very common thing that can happen in cornea and that creates the trouble. Inflammation, if it is anterior to the Bowman's membrane, that is called a superficial keratitis, and if it is occurring only in discrete patches, then it is superficial punctate keratitis. If it is occurring in the stroma, then it is deep keratitis, and this deep keratitis is further categorized as it could be a stromal, that is your interstitial keratitis, or it could be endothelitis, depending upon the direct involvement of the endothelium in the inflammatory process. So, all these terms are not new to us. We have seen the usage of all these terms. Basically, we have to understand this in quite detail. That what do we understand by the different terminologies that are used with respect to the keratitis? So, we all know that we have different layers in the cornea. We have anterior epithelium, we have Bowman's membrane, we have connective tissue, stroma, we have pre-Desmond's membrane, we have a Desmond's membrane, and we have endothelium. So, if I have inflammation in any of these layers, I will call it as keratitis. So, that is also very, very clear that I will call it as keratitis. So now, what is then superficial keratitis and what is deep keratitis? So whenever I am having inflammation anterior to the Bowman's membrane, involving the epithelium and the Bowman's membrane itself, then this will be called as superficial. This will be called as the superficial keratitis, and this also, if it is present just in, you know, punctate patches, then this will be called as superficial punctate keratitis. Again, a very, very common thing, even as an adverse effect due to drugs also, we do read in viral keratitis also, we do read the superficial punctate keratitis. While if it is happening in the stroma, then I call it as the deep keratitis. So, what is superficial and what is deep? That is very, very clear. Now, in the deep, we also have Desmond's membrane, we also have endothelium. So, depending upon, you know, whether it is just the stroma or it is just the endothelium or it is the stroma without the primary involvement of the epithelium and endothelium, then it is called as the interstitial keratitis. We have got different things, right? Now, let's start with the epithelium. In the epithelium, just the loss of epithelium is called as the epithelial defect, and the epithelial defect can be actually seen by 1% sodium fluorescein dye. That could be seen with the cobalt blue filtered light. You must have seen that whenever we do show you about the superficial punctate keratitis, you see a bluish film is there, and over that we have greenish dots. Why is it so? Because we are using a dye there. So what's the name of that dye? So epithelial defects clear, we usually use the fluorescein dye, and this dye is giving you that typical green color. This is giving you the typical green color, and what is the filter that we are using is your cobalt blue filter that we are using for it. If superficial without any inflammation, then if there is no inflammation, now this is again a very, very important point. If it is without the inflammation, then it is also called as the abrasion or erosion. So there is a difference between superficial pungent keratitis, abrasion or erosion, because keratitis will have that inflammatory component, but if I have just the abrasion or erosion, it will not have the inflammation. And this is usually healing within 12 to 24 hours by regeneration of the epithelial cells, right? While if I have a loss of epithelium with inflammation also in the surrounding area, then that is called as a corneal ulcer. So you can see that how minutely they are defining the terms. Inflammation of the cornea. It is visible as a grayish haze or a loss of clarity. So whenever you have inflammation, transparency will be hampered. You will see a loss of clarity, a haziness you can see is there. And if it is also accompanied with the outpouring of leukocytes, then the appearance will be not grayish, then it will become whitish or the yellowish one, and then that will be called as the infiltration. And we know that the corneal ulcers are sterile, as you know that we always discuss this, that the corneal hypopyons are always sterile and always mobile, so that you know. Okay. So this is the thing, can you see? This is your corneal epithelial defect, and you can see here, this is blue one, cobalt blue filter. This is your cobalt blue filter that we are using, and you can see a greenish patch. So this dye is actually the fluorescein dye. This is actually the fluorescein dye, and this is seen, wherever you are seeing these greenish areas, these are the areas of epithelial defect. Right, and very often now they are showing you these kind of pictures, so you should know this. Earlier they used to ask only the finding, but nowadays they are asking you the filter name also, the dye name also, the procedure also. So this is actually the slit lamp finding. So all these things are now become important. While if I talk about the scarring, it is the final outcome. So a punctate keratitis, just a keratitis, a superficial keratitis, a interstitial keratitis, a stromal keratitis, endothelitis, we have an erosion or an abrasion, we have a corneal ulcer, and we have a corneal scar. All these are different things. Unlike the healthy transparent cornea, the scar will be white, opaque, and the nature, extent and pattern, as well as the density of the scarring, will actually depend upon the original quality of the disease, what it was having, what was the extent. And then we can have some certain non-inflammatory diseases also that can also lead to scarring. So in this particular topic, we'll be seeing them all. Alright, so let's get started with the general clinical features, what are the symptoms, what are the signs, and what are the diagnosis. So we know that cornea can be affected by infections, injuries, we have keratitis, inflammation, we have dystrophies, degenerations, and even the cancerous conditions. So not many conditions could be presenting in the cornea. And cornea is a thing which is very, very important with respect to corneal transplantation also, with respect to corneal opacity also, in MPCB program as a cause of blindness also. So we do have many questions on cornea. Diseases manifesting in different ways are there. So what are the typical symptoms of corneal disease? Now this will actually help more in your viva voce also. Why? Because whenever they ask you, suppose there is a keratitis, suppose there is a corneal ulcer, what are the things that will happen? So always remember that what are the things that can happen in cases of corneal diseases. So we will have obviously diminishing of vision. It could be loss of transparency. It could be due to astigmatism. You have watering due to the nerve supply. You have redness. You have photophobia. These are the common things that you are going to have whenever you have corneal involvement, and this will also help in also in the clinical cases. So whenever you are solving the clinical cases, what are the things that will bound to think that this can be a corneal disease? So if I am getting all these things in my clinical case scenario, there's a diminution of vision with photophobia, redness, watering, foreign body sensation, pain, whiteness of the cornea, so I'll think about the corneal disease. So what is photophobia actually? Photophobia is a term which is applied for the discomfort, experience or exposure of the bright light. So why do we have photophobia in the corneal disorders? This is also due to the corneal irritation. And this is also accompanied by the blepharospasm. If you remember, we learned the BPL card in the congenital glaucoma. So B for blepharospasm was there. So both your photophobia as well as your blepharospasm, both of them are due to the corneal irritation because there is a stimulation of these corneal nerves which are coming from the ophthalmic division of the trigeminal nerve, and that is why we also have the headache or runny nose with all these things, because the ophthalmic division of the trigeminal nerve also have the other parts. We have a frontal division, lacrimal division, nasociliary division, and that's why we have accompaniments. The slightest attempt to separate the lids, especially if the attempt is made in the bright light, greatly increases the irritation. So whenever a patient is coming to me with a corneal ulcer, I should keep in mind that there could be a probability of the blepharospasm also. When I am trying to separate both the lids in order to visualize the cornea, I may not be able to see it. That is actually an indication of blepharospasm. It is not completely abolished in the dark, but diminished by the anesthetization. So again, important point, yes. Because this is taking place in the bright light does not mean that if I take the patient in the dark, that will completely, remove it. No. But yes, you can diminish it by giving the topical anesthesia kind of a thing. So it is actually a reflex which is predominantly involving the trigeminal nerve, and it's not triggered by the direct stimulation of the optic nerve by the exposure of the light. Again, a thoughtful thing because, it is not getting eliminated in dark, but it is eliminating by the anesthesia. So that is a thing that is showing that actually it is not triggered by the stimulation of light on the optic nerve. This is getting a reflex which is going through the ophthalmic division of the trigeminal nerve. That is proved, hence proved. Now the severe photophobia. Severe photophobia accompanies only denudation of epithelium, but many inflammatory diseases are accompanied by some iridocyclitis, spasm of the sphincter of the iris, ciliary muscle worsened by the optic nerve stimulation due to bright light increases the discomfort. This has an additive photophobic effect, which is illustrated clinically by the partial relief of these symptoms on giving the cycloplegic medications. Now, if I talk about the severe photophobia, they are saying that severe photophobia will occur only when there is, denudation of the epithelium. But yes, there are certain inflammatory conditions. If I talk about the uveitis, the anterior uveitis, that is there. And we know that in the anterior uveitis, we have ciliary muscle spasm, and that has a very, very prominent photophobia. And that is actually relieved by the cycloplegic effect. So yes, we have different degrees of photophobia and the different components are involved. Okay, so we have already discussed about the symptoms. Now talking about the signs of the corneal diseases. So signs are the things that you can see. So if you see that there is a loss of vision in the patient, so that was a symptom, but diminution of vision or loss of transparency, that will be a sign. So there will be diminution of vision. This will be a symptom. Loss of transparency of cornea will be a sign. Similarly, circumcorneal congestion is a sign, while the redness will be a symptom which the patient will complain of. Loss of smoothness of the surface, due to which the patient may complain of dryness. Patient may also complain due to the epithelial effect, the grittiness, the foreign body sensation could be there. Vascularization ki wajah se, there will be pain, there will be discomfort. So all these things are actually interrelated, but the thing is that if the patient is complaining, then it's a symptom, and if you are looking at, then it's a sign. Okay. Now the external examination of the cornea can be performed with the help of a torch, a magnifying loop, and slit lamp. And the most important is actually the slit lamp biomicroscopy. That is actually the first thing that we are doing nowadays. If there is a surface irregularities, then what you can do for the surface irregularities, they can be detected by the corneal reflex, placidoscleroscopic rings. This is very, very important. Sometimes they are also asking you the image-based question on this. They are giving you an image and they are asking you a question. Then in the lens, we have already talked about it, that curvature is done by the keratometry. Thickness is actually done by the pachymetry. So you should know this. Thickness can also be done with the help of a slit lamp, scanning topographic system. And the one thing that I always lay a very much stress about is your speculomicroscopy, because that is important for your transplantation part also. So we have corneal endothelium that can be seen by the specular microscopy. That is your slit lamp doing slit lamp in the zone of specular reflection. That is called as your speculomicroscopy. So that is again very, very important. And can you see? These are your endothelial cells, which are hexagonal in shape. If it is visible, I think it's visible like this. So these are your hexagonal cells, endothelial cells, and that is a very, very important part and a prerequisite before the corneal transplantation also, because it is the metabolically most active layer, the most vital layer. So if you have some problem with the number of endothelial cells, with the shape of endothelial cells, we should not give that cornea to the recipient. Then we'll be talking about the corneal opacities. There are three kind of corneal opacities: nebula, macula, and we have leucomas. Nebula is only just the slight opacification. So you can see all the details through the opacity. That is your nebula. Leucoma is whitish opacity, so you cannot see anything through it. And in between is a macula. So it is more dense, and only the partial details are visible here. So details of the iris cannot be seen, but only the margins are seen. In the leucoma, it is totally opaque, so you cannot see. So that is like we have got the nebula, then we have macula, and then we have leucomatous. Then we have got something called as the old central leucomata. Sometimes they show a horizontal pigmented line in the palpable aperture. This is due to the deposition of the cornea, which is coming from the tear film. That can also be there. And then a very important thing that you read with respect to the perforation of the bacterial corneal ulcer, and that is your aderent leucoma. So if the iris is aderent at the back of the leucoma, following the healing of a perforated corneal ulcer, that is aderent leucoma. So this is an important one. Now, if the perforation is a small one, iris will come and it will seal it. So that is your aberrant leucoma. But sometimes the perforation can be larger one also. Then what happens? So if the iris tissue is coming and it is incarcerated within the scar tissue, and we have got healing of a large swathed area, then that is called as a corneoanalytic scar or anterior spherulina. So this I'll be telling you after the bacterial ulcers also. See what happens. Suppose these are your layers of the cornea. Then we were having this iris here, and we were having the ciliary body. This is your lens, and here I was having this aqueous humor, right? Now, if I have ulcer, we have lot of anterior uveitis here. We have the ciliary muscle spasm here, and then we also have the release of inflammatory cells in the aqueous humor. Now suddenly, what is happening? There is a perforation. So this area gone here, and this area is also gone. So what is happening? So whole of the aqueous humor is coming out with the pressure. So this whole area becomes ictitic, and iris is coming out here. So this will actually lead to something which is called as the iris prolapse. So as a complication, we can also have the iris prolapse. Now what is happening along with this? The aqueous humor is also coming out, and when aqueous humor is coming out, the inflammatory cells are also coming out. So actually, it is forming a kind of pseudo cornea. It's not a cornea, it's just a pseudo cornea which is forming over the iris, lens, diaphragm, and over this starts the fibrosis. So this fibrotic layer is again forming a different layer of the false cornea. So this is called as your false cornea. So what is happening due to the pressure inside the aqueous humor, it is actually, you know, leading to the ectasia of the anterior cornea. So we have a bunch of grape-like appearance, something like this. We have a bunch of grape-like appearance. And that is why this condition is called as stephyloma. The word stephyloma comes from stephylos. That is bunch of grape-like appearance. So from here, we have got this word, that is anterior stephyloma. Again, an important thing. Okay. Now, if I talk about the diminution of vision in the corneal opacities, so a thin diffuse nebula covering the pupillary area interferes more with the vision than a strictly localized dense glaucoma, so long as the latter does not block the pupillary area. So this will give you a clear vision, that don't judge the visual acuity just on the basis of density of corneal opacity, as they are clearly saying that if there is a thin nebula and it's covering the pupillary area, is affecting the vision much more than a glaucoma which is not covering the pupillary area. So actually the extent of visual acuity which is affected depends more on what amount of pupillary area it is affecting or covering rather than its own density. This is because the glaucoma, what will do, glaucoma is going to stop all the light which falls upon it. Whereas nebula refracts it irregularly, allowing many of the rays to fall upon the retina where they blur and the image formed by the regularly reflected rays. Again, a very important question, and this has been asked in AIIMS previously. And I always used to get the questions that why actually they have given the answer as nebula and not the leucometers. I think now you got the picture that what I used to tell you, that it is said due to the irregular astigmatism that a nebula can affect more. Okay. Now, opacity does not necessarily prevent the light from being focused upon the retina immediately behind it. Thus, a small central or a paracentral opacity will not prevent the focusing of an object upon the macular area, for the rays passing through the clear peripheral areas of the cornea will be reflected towards the macula, and only those rays which are incident on the opaque region of the corneal surface are cut off. Thus, there is a loss of brightness rather than the definition, although this is impaired by superimposition of the diffuse endoptic image of the opacity upon the clear image of the external object. Now, they are trying to explain you that why actually there is not a total, complete loss of vision in cases of the total leucometous opacity. Just you have something, you know, loss of brightness rather than the definition. Why? Because the area is not totally preventing the rays to fall in the macula where the sharpest image of the object is formed. So still, the rays are coming from the periphery and they are going towards the macula. So we do not have, you know, complete loss of vision. Yes, we can have the loss of brightness and dimming that will be there. All right. Now coming to the corneal edema. Corneal edema can actually affect the entire cornea, but generally it is coming first in the epithelium, which becomes steamy in appearance due to the accumulation of fluid between the cells, especially the basal cells. At the same time, the accumulation of fluid between the lamellae around the nerve fibers of stroma produces a haziness in the entire cornea. If this edema is lasting for a longer period, then it also forms a vesicles or bulli, that is called as bullous keratopathy. So whenever we are talking about the corneal edema, if you remember in the last session we had discussed this, that there were junctional complexes in the epithelium and the endothelium, and whenever there is a disruption of these junctional complexes, we can have the stromal edema. So they are talking about this stromal edema due to the problem with the epithelium. So if I am getting a problem in the epithelium, and due to this the fluid is going inside, okay, there is a collection of the fluid, then that can lead to the formation of vesicles also. Bulli formation could be there. And that is actually called as the vesicular keratopathy or the bullous keratopathy. This is particularly an intractable condition. Frequently, we have intense pain and symptoms of ocular irritation also. Such corneal edema may occur in many inflammatory conditions also, degenerative conditions. It's common in glaucoma also. After trauma could be there, any surgery could be there, like after the cataract surgery also we were having this bullous keratopathy. So we can have this edema in quite many conditions. Then there is a thing called as a striate keratopathy. Striate keratopathy is again a kind of a corneal edema. This is again occurring after the cataract surgery as a complication, which is seen as a complication after the operations on the globe, in which the peripheral corneal section has been made, especially in the cataract extraction. So I told you. So we are having the striate keratitis also. We can have stromal edema also, bullous keratopathy also. And you can see the delicate gray lines, they are running from the wound and they are passing completely across the cornea. Then we can have the radial stria. Radial stria is seen as the around the wounds or the ulcers due to the cause and due to the distension of these spaces by edema. Then fine hatching, which is seen around the ulcers, is similar. So the striate keratitis means the deeper layers we are having the problem, and striate discrete keratitis can lead to formation of a grayish colored lines that could be there, and then they disappear spontaneously as the wound heals, and due to the folding of the cornea. And radial stria can also be there because, you know, when we have edema, there is actually separation of the interlamellar spaces. So that leads to stretching, and that stretching can also lead to the appearance of the stria. Then coming to the filamentary keratopathy. Filamentary keratopathy is the formation of the epithelial threads. Filaments, from there the word filament is coming. So we have filaments which adhere to the cornea by one end, while the if you look at the other end, okay, that is club shaped, that is moving freely. So these filaments are actually producing the irritation, foreign body sensation, and they also occur in degenerative conditions, corneal edema, keratitis, collagen vascular diseases, as well as the dry eyes. So basically, whenever you see this word filamentary keratitis, that means you are having the filaments, and these filaments are found in which layer? Epithelial layer. And whenever you have something in the epithelial layer, they are actually causing more of surface problems. So we will have a problem of irritation, foreign body sensations, something like this. So see, this is the patient who is having your dry eye disease, having the filamentary keratitis. So previously it was something like this. Can you see? We are having these so many punctate lesions. These are your punctate lesions of the filamentary keratopathy, which you can see. So after the steroids, it was all clear. You cannot see any green area. So there is no epithelial defect, right? Now the KPs. So we have read about KPs a lot in cases of anterior uveitis. So what are these keratic precipitates? They were initially called as the keratitis punctata. These are actually the inflammatory cells that you know. These are leukocytes or other cells, encyclitis, adipocyclitis, maybe choroiditis. And you should never overlook them because they are showing you acute activity. And sometimes they are the only signs of the serious disease. And they are usually present on the posterior surface of the cornea. And you have to remember that even the deeper layers may be infiltrated, and we have discussed quite a lot about these KPs in uveitis. Now, hypobion. Hypobion is again important whenever we are talking about the bacterial corneal ulcers, especially. Hypo and pion. If I talk about this, hypo means the down and pion means pus. So, pus is there. So, in a simple language, I can say that there is a pus in the anterior chamber. So, whenever I have a pus in the anterior chamber, that is called as a hypobion. And this pus is nothing but the polymorpho leukocytes. They are accumulating in the lower angle of anterior chamber and they get embellished in the fibrin network. So, they are seen in the corneal ulcers as a collection of pus in the anterior chamber. So, this is the real definition of a hypobion, right? Corneal ulcers are associated with iritis owing to the diffusion of toxins. Now, why we have these leukocytes released, release of polymorpho nuclear lymphocytes, why it is there? This is due to the diffusion of toxins, which is coming from the bacteria. Or we can find these hypopions in the fungal hyphae also. So, it could be due to the invasion of fungal hyphae. So, resultant iritocyclitis will lead to the outpouring of leukocytes. Leukocytes being heavy, they will settle at the bottom, and therefore we have hypobion. Now, the
development
development
of
of hypopyon actually depends upon two factors. One is the virulence and one is the resistance. So, how much actually the organism is virulent and how much is the inflammatory reaction of that ocular defense mechanism. Many of the bacteria we know produce dangerous hypopyons also. So, many pyogenic bacteria, if I talk about the staphylococcus, streptococcus, gonococcus, pneumococcus, pseudomonas, they are producing these hypopyons. But unless the organism is very, very virulent, some lack of resistance on the part of tissues must be present. Okay. Hypopyon ulcers are much more common in a particular kind of patients, that is old, debilitated, and alcoholic patients. So, unless they are seeing that the organism is very, very virulent, normally you will not have hypopyon. Only if there is a resistance of immunity in the person, then you will have hypopyon, or the person is old, debilitated, comorbidity, or alcoholic, all these things. So it's important to remember that the hypopyon is usually sterile, since the leukocytosis is due to the toxins, not due to the actual invasion. And obviously, actual invasion is also not possible in cases of bacteria because they do not have the hyphae. And they cannot actually pass through your Leishmans membrane. This accounts for the ease and rapidity with which the hypopyon is often absorbed, and usually we do not give any separate treatment for the hypopyons in cases of bacteria. So it may develop in an hour or two, rapidly it can disappear and then rapidly reappear. So this is again a very important thing, that hypopyon is not a permanent thing. Hypopyons are coming due to the toxins released by the bacteria, so it can come, it can disappear, and then again also it can come. Then if I talk about the other thing that hypopyon of the bacterial ulcers are seen with, that it is mobile also. So hypopyon is a fluid always moving towards the lowest part of the anterior chamber depending upon the patient's head. So always remember that in cases of bacterial hypopyons, they are always sterile. They are always sterile and they are always mobile. So they can move to the most dependent part also. This is true about the bacterial one. It may be so small that it is scarcely visible, being hidden behind the rim of the sclera, which is overlapping the cornea. Sometimes it's very, very small also. It may reach halfway up to the iris, or means it depends upon what is the size of the hypopyon. Hypopyon, if it is fluidic, will be seen to shift. A change in the fluid level will with the tilting of the head. So if the patient is having a bacterial colon ulcer and patient is tilting the head, you will find that the hypopyon is also moving. That is the meaning of mobile. A larger hypopyon and that which is due to the fungal infections are usually less fluid owing to the fibrinous network, and we also have invasion. So always remember that it is sterile plus mobile in cases of the bacterial corneal ulcer, while it is non-sterile. It is non-sterile because fungal hyphae have the capability of invasion, plus non-mobile also. Plus it is non-mobile in cases of fungal. So you have to always remember this. So these are actually non-sterile, they are immobile and less readily absorbed also. So when the hypopyons are the same kind of entity, but the properties of hypopyon with respect to the bacterial and with respect to the fungal are quite different. It is usually unnecessary to remove the pus, again important thing, and as is the rule with other parts. So if you remember, I usually always mention you this, that if you go by the surgery dictum, that pus anywhere in the body should be drained does not held true for the hypopyon because it is actually sterile. Alright. However, in some cases of recalcitrant fungal ulcers, anterior chamber tap to test for the fungal invasion or anterior chamber wash may be required, but not as a routine thing. We do not require it. Another important topic is your enlarged corneal nerves, and we have a lot of questions on this enlarged corneal nerves. You must have seen in your GTs also, so let's go about it. So whenever you have these prominent corneal nerves or the enlarged corneal nerves, it's not always necessary that they have symptoms. So it could be asymptomatic and we have just the accidental detection. So the corneal nerves are known to be enlarged. So what are the DDs? I have mentioned this in the group also. I have made one flashcard and I have circulated it. So you can note down, we have the multiple endocrine neoplasia, that is type 2. where you have the combination of medullary carcinoma, few cytochroma, few chromocytoma, and then we have the mucosal neuromas, and then we have got neurofibromatosis, Ripson syndrome, keratoconus, keratitis, which keratitis? Acanthamoebic keratitis, fused endothelial dystrophy, trauma, and congenital glaucoma. So simply, we learn all these things separately, and you can note down at one place as a DD, and we always tend to get the questions related to this, all right? So always remember this. So this is a picture which is showing you the enlarged corneal nerves also. And then another important thing is your vascularization. Now, vascularization, I don't think that they will ask you directly, but yes, again, it's very important when you are solving your clinical case scenarios. So, you know that cornea is avascular in order to maintain its transparency, but the vascularization with respect to cornea is very, very important. Corneal diseases may induce the invasion of the cornea, and you may get two kinds of vascularization. One is your superficial and one is your deep one. Corneal diseases may induce the invasion of the cornea with the blood vessels from the limbus. So, it could be superficial involving the epithelium and anterior to the Bowman's membrane, which will be just an arborizing pattern. Whenever it is superficial, it is just an arborizing pattern, or it could be deep in the stroma with the radial arrangement. So, this goes true whenever there is congestion, there is vascularization. If it is superficial, it is arborizing. If it's deep, it's radial, and the vessels may become atrophic and regress, or they may remain as the host vessels that we discussed previously also. And then we have the keratitis. So keratitis we will be taking in the next session, because keratitis we have to deal in detail, and we have different kinds of keratitis. I think this is all for today's session. We have learned some of the very, very important aspects of the pathophysiology of the cornea, and lot many extra edge questions have been covered. So please try to go through them, try to read the lessons along with me and feel the difference. Thank you, and happy ophthalmology.